Welcome back to your irregularly scheduled robot lawnmower content. Today we're going to take a look at the Wi-Fi enabled base station that I use for GPS RTK injection, as well as Mavlink radio telemetry. Everything is powered by this 25 amp hour solar charger. I think I got this charger through a promotional giveaway of some sort, but I liked it so much that I bought a second one that I use in other projects all the time. If you've followed this project for any length of time, you've probably figured out that I'm a huge fan of the uBlox F9P. It really plays well with the ArduPilot ecosystem. This one is the ArduSimple Simple RTK2B breakout board. I actually used three of these for the lawnmower project, this one being the fixed base and then the moving base and rover on the lawnmower itself. I'm using the multi-band magnetic patch antenna provided by ArduSimple. It's mounted right now on top of this crusty old saw blade as a ground plane, which works fine, but probably owe it to myself at some point to replace that with something a little more weatherproof. The antenna is always positioned directly over this rock with this distinctive crater in the top. I surveyed in this position to some ridiculous level of accuracy, but the reality is I really didn't need to do that because I'm after precision and not necessarily exact geographic accuracy. If I just use the same physical position for the antenna every time and then give it the same fixed coordinates to use for its corrections, then I always get repeatable results on the lawnmower regardless of the actual position on the face of the earth. This spot is pretty central to the property, and I get really good reception pretty much anywhere on the 2-acre property, even when sometimes the signal is masked by the house. Telemetry is handled by this Holybro 915MHz SICK radio unit. I've replaced the stock antenna with one that's just a little bit better tuned. The brains of the operation is a Raspberry Pi 3, running a slick piece of software called Sear2Net, which allows serial traffic to be transmitted over a local network. The reason I chose a Wi-Fi architecture like this is that I'd like to be able to keep the laptop physically separated from the base station outside. This way I can just drag the tripod out to its designated rock, apply power, and then go inside to my office where the laptop is, plan the waypoints for the mowing pattern that I want to do, and then keep the laptop connected for RTCM3 injection and data logging. Now let's go inside and check out some of the software setup. Fair warning, we're about to go from nerdy to super nerdy. What you see here is a secure shell connection to the Raspberry Pi. The command shown on screen is the one that you need to run in order to install Sear2Net. APT is the package manager for Raspbian, the operating system. Install means just that. Sear2Net is the package that we want to install, so to speak. And then sudo is super user do. It's a great command. It works great on your wife. For example, this week I crashed my drone and I need about $300 to fix it. So I asked for $300 and she said no. So I said, sudo, let me spend $300 and we're going to have a drone that flies this week. The next step is to create what's called a UDEV rule. This will make sure that every time the Raspberry Pi boots, the GPS and the telemetry radio will have the same name, and therefore Sear2Net will know where to find them and how to repeat the information. We'll create and edit a file called 98 persistent TTY rules. The number 98 is just arbitrary, it's not in use already by UDEV, and then a name for the file that identifies it for what it does. It resides in the /lib/udev-rules.d directory. I realize this file looks very cryptic and maybe a little bit hard to follow, even if you have a working knowledge of Linux. For your particular setup, you may actually have to edit some of the things that are in quotes. The easiest way to get that information is with a command that I haven't shown on screen. It's called lsusb. It should be somewhat straightforward to replace what I have here with whatever the output of lsusb shows. The reason there are four different lines for the GPS is that the way uBlox identifies itself to the operating system, the only way to get a somewhat persistent name is to identify on which physical USB port it was plugged into. So if I plug the GPS unit into one particular port, it'll show as GPS0. If I move it to the port next door, it'll show as GPS1, and so on and so forth. For that reason, I always make sure I plug the GPS into the same physical port on the Raspberry Pi. You can overcome that a little bit with some of the Sear2Net configuration that I'll show you later, but you may avoid some frustration by making sure that you plug the GPS into the same place every time. Now we need to edit the Sear2Net configuration file in the etc directory to make sure that it knows where to find the devices we just set up and how to output them. For the GPSs, I prefer UDP, and for the Mavlink telemetry, I prefer TCP. Mission Planner will successfully connect to the GPS on UDP. It won't, in my experience, provide a reliable connection on UDP to a Mavlink serial output. Also, you can see a commented line for TCP output for the GPS. I've found that uCenter, if you want to try to connect to the GPS via uCenter, UCenter will not reliably connect via UDP. Regardless, what's in white here is what's important. For all four GPS lines, there's one line each to repeat their output on the network via UDP on ports 4000 through 4003. And then on port 2000 TCP, you can see the Mavlink repeater on the telemetry antenna. I'll show in a few minutes that there's actually kind of a matter of convenience as well for using UDP for one and TCP for the other within Mission Planner. The last requirement is a systemd service to tell the Raspberry Pi to start repeating serial traffic over the network on every boot. Create a file called sirtunet.service that looks just like this one in the systemd directory. Use the system control command to enable the service on every boot. And then to start the service without rebooting, we can use system control start. Okay, that's it for the painful part. Now we'll cruise over to Mission Planner, go to the Setup tab, click RTK GPS Inject, drop down to UDP Client, and click Connect. In the pop-up, you put the IP address or the host name, in my case, Rover Base, and then type in the port number, 4000 for GPS 0. After a few seconds, the screen will populate with satellite and status information indicating that it's ready to transmit over Mavlink. Select TCP on the Mavlink connection, click Connect, same host name, port 2000 for the telemetry connection, and click Connect. The mower's not turned on right now, so we won't actually see telemetry. If you noticed, when I clicked on the UDP connection for the GPS and TCP connection for the telemetry, the host name and port numbers were already filled out. Mission Planner does remember the last UDP or TCP connection and attempt to pre-fill that, but if you're using UDP for both or TCP for both, then you'll have to alternate typing the port number between the two. So the fact that I can't connect reliably with UDP for the telemetry actually becomes a matter of convenience in Mission Planner. That's going to do it for this one. Thanks for bearing with me with all the command line geekery, and I'll try to be back again soon with another in-depth look at this project.